morning, everyone, and welcome. I would like to, first of all, to point out there's lots of room on this side at the front, so if you feel a little bit of this, move on over to this side. I would like to start with a very big welcome to Deborah, or Debs Ferber. Welcome, Debs. She is an ordained minister with the United Church of Canada, serving at the Mount Royal Emmanuel United Church in Saskatoon. So she came a long way to be with us today. She was... Yes. Thank you, Saskatoon, for looking her to us for today. She was just ordained on June 16th of this year. She is also a chaplain of the Luther Heights Care Community, which is an independent living seniors residence. Debs grew up on Willow Drive in Ruthven and used to spend many hours in our beautiful church gardens here. And I am sure she is very grateful to be back here at the Olinda Ruthven Church, which encouraged her in her ministry training. I'd also like to welcome her friends and family who have made it out today. So welcome, Debs, and we look forward to your words today. In other celebrations, we're celebrating Bob, Andy, Tony, who's here at the back. I don't know if he's going to tell us how old he is, so we'll just guess. And Laura is also celebrating a birthday this week. And we have one anniversary this week on the 23rd, Laura and Michael. So we congratulate all those who are celebrating. Most of the announcements you are familiar with, as they are emailed out in our letter. If you're not getting them, please contact the church office. Just one announcement to point out, the Ruthven Yard Sale is on August the 3rd from 7 until 1. There is a barbecue by donation. Drop off items for sale on Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays between 9 and 12. We do need volunteers for sorting. There may be some treasures that you're willing to part with so that someone else can enjoy them. There are 3 sign-up sheets at the back. One for the bake sale, one for the yard sale, and one for the barbecue, and they're lacking a little bit in name, so if you could add your autograph to one of those sheets, it would be greatly appreciated. On behalf of the congregation, I would also like to give our deepest sympathies to the Austin family. We are so very sorry for your loss. Does anyone have any other announcements?
There's coffee and goodies this after church.
Coffee and goodies after church. Grace, did you want to say something?
I would like to thank members of the congregation for their prayers and their thoughts during the time that we have lost Doug, and it's been much appreciated, and the flowers in the sanctuary this morning are from his funeral.
Oh, they are lovely, lovely flowers, so thank you so much. Thank you for sharing Doug's memory with us. Thank you, Doug. Take it away.
Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And it's so glad to be back here today. As mentioned, my legal or official title is the Reverend Deborah Ferber, but I am affectionately known as Rev Debs, or just as Debs. So actually, last week I preached at Roseland Trinity United Church in Windsor, which was my home congregation when I lived in Windsor. And the former minister who just retired, Laura Jo, she said that I need to get a license plate, Rev Debs. So thinking about it. But it's really great to be back here. I've spent a lot of time going to different United Churches in Saskatoon. Before I had my own church, Mount Royal Emmanuel, I would travel around to various churches and do pulpit supply. And I like all churches, you know, if they're in a city or the countryside, but I just feel there's something really familiar and comfortable about a country church, and just more relaxed, casual, and I really like that a lot. And I used to go to VBS here at this church, and I saw the poster that you're still doing that, so that's really nice that we can continue to reach the young children in our community. And I also used to take karate lessons at Blair Hall. I don't know if you still do karate here, but I used to. Okay, I used to go do karate lessons at Blair Hall. So great to be back. And now we will begin with the call to worship. We gather in the name of Jesus Christ, members of God's family, and brothers and sisters to one another. There are no outsiders here among us. No one has any special standing or bragging rights, for we have been brought together by the redeeming love of Jesus. Let us join together in worship. And now let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Join us together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may become a holy temple acceptable to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And our opening hymn is Draw the Circle Wide, number 145, in More Voices. I started working at my new church, Mount Royal Emmanuel. So I've been there 3 months, but they take July off. So that's how I end up coming to Ontario. It's just a small church and a lot of people go away for vacation and everything. So I decided that today I would teach you some songs that we do at my church. And so we started this thing when we do sharing the peace of Christ. We share the peace of Christ as normal, but we start with this song. So the song goes, Salam alaikum, which is peace be with you in Arabic. It's repeated 4 times. Salam alaikum, salam alaikum, salam alaikum, salam alaikum. And then there are actions. And peace be in your heart, and peace be in your home, and peace be in our land, and peace be in our world. And we'll sing it three times just so people get the hang of it, and you can join at any verse when you feel comfortable enough to join in. So there's no music to this, so it's a cappella. So I'll sing it through the first time, just so you know the rhythm or the tune, and then if you feel comfortable, you can join in the second and third time. So it goes like this. Salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum. And peace be in your heart, and peace be in our home, and peace be in our land, and peace be in our world. Salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum. And peace be in your heart, and peace be in your home, and peace be in our land, and peace be in our world. Salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum, salaam alaikum. And peace be in our heart, and peace be in our home, and peace be in our land, and peace be in our world.
Oh, you're all naturals.
You caught on very quickly. Quicker than my church did at first. That's actually a song I learned through the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada, because as I mentioned, I also work half-time with Lutherans. So now, peace be with you. And we can take a moment to wish peace to those who are sitting closest to us. Now we will continue with our confession of sin and assurance of forgiveness. Wondrous and mysterious God, we give you thanks and praise for the many ways you come to us and offer us abundant life. When evening falls and we find ourselves in deserted and lonely places, we know we can count on you to provide for our needs. For the times you show us the way when we are lost and in need of guidance, we give gratitude. For the times you provide healing when we are broken and in need of restoration, we rejoice. For the times you welcome us as host when we are hungry and in need of nourishment, we sing of your wonderful works. Your grace makes the poor rich, the hungry satisfied, the weak strong. Your grace empowers the dying to live and the despairing to find hope. And so we worship you as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As we gather to worship you, we are aware that we have fallen short of the life you desire for us. Through Christ, you show us the way of compassion, generosity, and forgiveness. Yet we continue to neglect the suffering of others. We blame and judge in the very moments we are called to act with kindness and mercy.
We fearfully hold on to what we own rather than share our blessings with others. We choose to nurture old wounds instead of letting go and offering forgiveness. Help us to be free of greed and the desire for self-preservation. Open our hearts so that we may embody your teachings and way of life. Amen.
Friends, hear the good news. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Know that you are forgiven, forgive one another, and be at peace. And here's another song. This one is not, as far as I know, it's not on the slideshow here, but it's really easy to learn. Here's another song I've been teaching my congregation in Saskatoon, also from the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada, ELCIC. It says, I am opening up in sweet surrender to the luminous love light of the One. So I'll sing it through three times. The first time I'll sing so that you know the tune, and if you feel like you can catch on, you can join for the second and third time. So it goes like this. I am opening up in sweet surrender to the luminous love light of the One. I am opening up in sweet surrender to the luminous love light of the One. I am opening up in sweet surrender to the luminous love light of the One. And now the choir will be providing an anthem for us.
The child of time, ring out the bells of the night.
Lottie Sharp up, and she will be doing the scripture passage for today.
Good morning. Now, I'm going to apologize before I start this because I set my reading glasses down somewhere. I can just see you, Dick. bad habit. So, if I stumble here and there, please forgive me. So, let's do the prayer for illumination. Holy God, your miracles surround and astound us each day. May the Spirit come upon us now so that we would not rely on our own wisdom, but on yours as we read the scriptures together. Amen. Our reading today is taken from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 22. Let us listen for the word of the Lord. But don't take any of this for granted. It was only yesterday that you outsiders to God's ways had no idea of any of this, didn't know the first thing about the way God works, hadn't the faintest idea of Christ. You knew nothing of that rich history of God's covenants and promise in Israel, hadn't a clue about what God was doing in the world at large. Now, because of Christ dying that death, shedding that blood, you who were once out of it altogether are in on everything. The Messiah has made things up between us so that we're now together on this, both non-Jewish outsiders and Jewish insiders. He tore down the wall we used to keep each other at a distance. He repealed the law code that had become so clogged with fine print and footnotes that it hindered more than it helped. Then he started over. Instead of continuing with two groups of people separated by centuries of animosity and suspicion, he created a new kind of human being, a fresh start for everybody. Christ brought us together through his death on the cross. The cross got us to embrace, and that was the end of the hostility. Christ came and preached peace to you outsiders and peace to us insiders. He treated us equals, and so made us equals. Through him, we both share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. That's plain enough, isn't it? You're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom of faith is now your home country. You're no longer strangers. You're no longer strangers, outsiders. You belong here with as much right to the name Christian as anyone. God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how we got here. What he is building. He used the apostles and prophets for the foundation. Now he's using you, filling you in brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as the cornerstone that holds all the parts together. We see it taking shape day after day. A holy temple built by God, all of us built into it, a temple in which God is quite at home. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Lottie. So, I recently came across a funny Facebook cartoon, or as my generation would call it, a meme. This is what it said. The Church Unity Workshop has been postponed until the deacons can agree on the date, time, and color of the participants' name tags.
Yeah.
Sure, we've all had that experience that we've served on a church council or committee. One of the things I like about the United Church is that we're a very uniting church. Church united and uniting. That's our motto. So our society has long been searching for peace, and I'm sure that people here might be familiar with some of these famous songs. I'm sort of an amateur musician, like not really a musician, but I love music. I love to sing karaoke, I love to sing in choirs. And so I've really gotten into some of the kind of oldie style music. I really love it. And so some of my favorite songs from this era, John Lennon's Imagine, Louis Armstrong's What a Wonderful World, these kind of songs that talk about peace in our world. We often talk about being better together, practicing kindness. Some of the young people are wearing shirts these days, they say, in a world where you can be anything, be kind. And the Apostle Paul told us in Romans that as much as it depends on us, we should live at peace with one another. But in our human desire to make the world a more peaceful and loving place, we still have to face worldly tensions. So right now, there's a heated debate in the US about the presidential elections. I don't have to get into it. If you're anything like my father, you've been watching the news all week and that's all they're talking about. There's also the conflict in the Middle East, Israel-Palestine. There's a lot of division right now about human sexuality. Where does life begin? Global warming. There's all sorts of really divisive topics. Racial tension and disparity of wealth exist within our systemic brokenness. Humanity has always had an entitled sense of determining who is in and who is out. And this attitude has been around since biblical times. So today's passage deals with finding unity and honoring diversity and breaking down dividing walls so that we can have free access to the Father. When Ephesians was written, the Jews and Gentiles, they didn't like each other very much. So the Gentiles thought the Jews were self-righteous because they had a law code that was clogged down with fine prints and footnotes. And likewise, the Jewish people saw the Roman Gentiles as an unwanted force that was occupying their land. The Jewish people insisted that the Gentiles should partake of all their Jewish rites and rituals in order to be full members. And that included circumcision. But the Gentiles thought it was unnecessary. And that worked for a little bit, except that eventually there were more Gentile converts to Christianity than Jewish converts. So now the Gentiles end up obeying the Jewish people. So at this time, the temple literally had a dividing wall allowing the Jews into the inner court while keeping the outermost court reserved for Gentiles. So the court was completely removed from the rest of the temple. And signs told the Gentiles that if they entered into the temple, they would be met with the death penalty. So the Gentiles were not worthy or holy enough to enter into the sacred space. But Jesus broke down this dividing wall through his death, and the Jewish believers did not catch on immediately to that fact, which unfortunately shows that turning to Christ does not always equal an immediate change of character. So the Gentiles were considered strangers and foreigners without any real stake in the economy and country of God. They were unaware of the rich history of God's covenantal promise with Israel. Like tourists, they were able to learn about God's grace, but they could never fully participate or be invited into it. And the Apostle Paul challenged this notion. Paul stated that all people are equal for heavenly citizenship, and they can all be fully welcomed inside the circle of God's love and purpose to be part of his beautiful and constantly growing handiwork. So as the Message paraphrase puts it, which is the paraphrase that we just read today from Scripture, Paul told the Gentiles, "You belong here with just as much a right to the name Christian as anyone." Sadly, even in the most beautiful of Canadian citizen cities, racism still mars the landscape. I love Saskatoon very much. It's a great place, but there is still racism and prejudice there against certain people groups. So every day, people in our country and other countries are being profiled and treated different because their culture or a different color of skin. And this is why cultural bridge building is necessary. So in Saskatoon, there's a group that started up about a year ago. It's called the People's Bridge Advocacy, and is formed by a man named Sinos Timon, and he operates cultural cafes. Sinos is actually a refugee from South Sudan. These monthly cafes offer an opportunity to learn about different countries and cultures, Try ethnic foods, learn ethnic dances, hear about the history and geography of different nations, and to meet new friends. And in just a few hours, participants are transported across the globe and feel like they have landed into a different country without needing a passport or needing to go on a plane. And the best part is that all the events are free, so they're all covered by grants or donations, and there's no barriers, everybody can participate in them. In a very real way, these cultural cafes are living into the heartbeat of the gospel through celebrating diversity. They allow us to practice hospitality, honor multiculturalism, appreciate differences, live in harmony, and love all people. Yet not everyone is so quick to jump on this gospel love wagon. It was about a year ago, I was really saddened to see that there was a large church in Windsor, and they were hosting a gospel and culture conference, but all of their speakers were white, middle-aged men. And I decided to broach my concern to this church leadership by asking, you're having this gospel and culture, you know, kind of seminar, and there was no diversity. And they replied back to me by saying that I was being divisive in my understanding of what diversity is, and they stated that diversity, equity, and inclusion were part of the liberal Christian agenda. But the Bible is very clear that loving our multicultural neighbors is a reflection of our salvation. Belief that salvation is solely forgiveness of individual sins limits it. Rather, it is embodied through integrating God's work of redemption and reconciliation for all people. Salvation is a byproduct of shalom. The Jewish people understand shalom as being rooted in peace, wholeness, security, completeness, and perfection. And I recently, about a year ago, I started doing these mini courses through an online website called My Jewish Learning. If anyone wants to know more about Judaism, it's all free and you can access it. So according to My Jewish Learning, shalom is, quote, the webbing together of God, humans, and all creation in justice, fulfillment, and delight. And that's the end of the quote. Shalom is more than a blessing, it is a divine manifestation of grace. It is the whole basis of the scriptures. As Christians, we do not just believe that Christ came to bring us peace, we believe that Christ is our peace. So this week, may we search for opportunities to learn about other cultures and share our culture with other people. May we seek to build bridges that promote gospel-centric and radical love of all people. May we seek to find the outsider and welcome them in. Amen. And now we are going to sing our next hymn, There Is Room for All, number 62, More Voices.
Thank you. given. Take and use our gifts then, that we in turn might overflow with love for the world as well. Amen.
Since then, I've kind of taken it as a song of my own, because I feel it, well, it's my theme song as a Christian. It's called simply, Why Me, Lord? Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you show? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I need it, just so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I
pastoral prayer. God, we are aliens and sojourners in this world, but you invite us to be your guests. You lavishly offer us your hospitality and lovingly welcome us into your family. You invite us to share in the abundance of your kingdom. God, you have shown us that providing hospitality to strangers opens a doorway into the kingdom of God. Remind us that when we offer hospitality to others, we are receiving Christ into our midst and so fulfilling the law of love. We open our hearts to embrace the stranger, the friend, the rich, and the poor. We offer our lives to offer a generous heart toward all. Joining together, we say the words that Christ taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And our sending hymn is May the Grace of Christ, number 419, in Voices United. Sisters, through the blood of Jesus Christ. Together we are being built into a holy dwelling place where God lives by the Spirit. So go out with joy and confidence to love and serve the world, for we do not go alone.